Hello, welcome back to Primitive Recursive March. Last time I showed that not every computable function was primitive recursive. Here, I'm not just talking about computer programs that don't always halt. Of course, those won't be primitive recursive. I'm talking about computer programs that always halt on every input, but nonetheless aren't primitive recursive, like the Ackermann function, because they take too long to calculate to be primitive recursive. This raises an expressiveness type question. What can we add to the primitive recursive functions to get all computable functions? Unfortunately, whatever we add is going to open up the possibility of not halting. The line between programs that always halt and programs that don't always halt is shrouded in Gödel's incompleteness theorem style nonsense. We have programs that should always halt, but can't be proved in ZFC to always halt, things like that. And so there isn't going to be a nice thing that we can add to our primitive recursive functions to take us exactly to that line and not over. In the first video in this series, we saw multiple ways of looking at the primitive recursive functions. We saw that we could reason about primitive recursive functions in a pretty robust programming language, one with bounded for loops and no recursive function calls, but everything else that you could hope for. And we also defined our primitive recursive functions more abstractly in terms of primitive recursion, defining f of x plus 1 in terms of f of x via other functions we had already shown to be primitive recursive. In this video, I want to explain various different ways to augment these models to get all computable functions. We can unlock the full power of computable functions by adding in one of a number of different features to our programming languages. One feature we could add is arbitrary while loops, or equivalently arbitrary for loops, continuing looping until a condition is met with no upper bound on the number of times that we loop. Once you've convinced yourself that we can represent Turing machines and their update functions with primitive recursive functions, it's easy to see that adding in while loops gives us arbitrary computation. We simply simulate a Turing machine and keep updating it in a while loop until the Turing machine halts. And in light of the result from the previous video, it should be clear that updating our representation of the Turing machine is primitive recursive, because you can do this in a reasonable amount of time. We could also add in the ability to do arbitrary recursive function calls, allowing a function to determine its value for a particular output based on any of its other values, not just its value at n minus 1. That would also allow us to do arbitrary computations. We can construct a function f of n that interprets n as a complete encoding of the current state of a Turing machine and outputs the final output of that Turing machine once it's finished running. The main recursion we need is that f of the number encoding one state of a Turing machine should be equal to f of a number encoding the next state. But this could mean that we're defining f of n in terms of f of potentially larger values. When our Turing machine doesn't halt, this corresponds to defining f of n in terms of itself, or possibly an infinite chain of values. And hopefully you can see here that we're doing pretty much the same thing. These two things, while loops and recursive function calls, are kind of different ways of expressing the same thing. Another feature we could add to get the full power of computable functions is the mu operator. This takes in a variable, say y, and a predicate, and finds the smallest y satisfying phi, and of course it's undefined if there is no such y. As before, we can use our ability to represent moving a Turing machine one step forward in its computation as a primitive recursive function, and this new operation to represent moving a Turing machine as many steps forward as it needs to halt. This process is described in Kleene's normal form theorem, which describes every computable function by looking for the smallest x encoding a run of the eth Turing machine on input n. Specifically, first, on the inside, we have some primitive recursive predicate t that takes in a number e representing which computable function we want to calculate, so some sort of number representing our computer program. which Turing machine we want to emulate, and then N, which represents the input to the Turing machine, and X, and returns true if X is a representation of the run of our Turing machine on input N. We then look for the smallest such X, the smallest run, and there should only be one, if there are any, and finally apply a primitive recursive function U, which will extract the output from our complete run X. And of course, if there's no finite run X, our mu operator returns undefined, and so, as expected, our function F returns undefined, right? So we can handle the case where F is given by an arbitrary computer program, even one that doesn't always halt. There's a bit of reasoning you have to do first to see that we can talk about lists of numbers, specifically lists of steps of a computation using primitive recursive functions. But once you do, it might start to make sense that this also provides the same boost in expressiveness as our while loops and recursive function calls. So, thanks for watching! So far, we've seen various equivalent presentations of primitive recursive functions, we've seen a proof that not all computable functions are primitive recursive, and we've seen how to extend our methods of presenting primitive recursive functions to present all computable functions. In the next video, I want to talk about a really exciting expressiveness result. We can remove a bunch of functionality from our definition of primitive recursive functions without reducing the expressiveness. A seemingly much more limited definition will still describe the same collection, the collection of primitive recursive functions. I hope that you'll join me for that. In the meantime, please leave any questions or comments below, and embrace kindness.